An oil painting that I did in New York City back in early winter of 1965. As I approach the city with foreboding, the rain falls on the wind, rain on the fly, stepping out from the forest. The sky is alight with flame as the telephone poles turn to gallows. Huge windowless towers filled with strangers. Filled to the brim with strangers. Remain strangers to each other. Promise only a world devoid of aesthetics. I leave the forests of Long Island and Tober, my little dog. The forests. You wouldn't believe it. I had trouble pronouncing forests. Forests. It's easier to hear than forests. Can you copy on that? Anyway, the forests are beautiful, impressive environments, especially if you've had the privilege to grow up, even for a little while, in or nearby them. The most legendary are places like the forests of Poland or Siberia. I understand they're both on the wane. Poland is shrinking. The Poland forest was so big in the mid-20th century that the armies of World War II had to go around them. And there were still huge mammals in there. What were they? The wild oxen or something like that, Poland. And then Siberia, I understand that it's being thinned out so badly by logging. Amazing, huh? But I don't know. I might have to go to the burger place, get some ketchup so I can catch up on my homework. Okay. The most legendary places, like the forests of Poland and Siberia, though I hear they're fast disappearing, are absolutely the most legendary places. But as a teenager, I visited nearly every day and camped out in, as much as possible, the younger, newer forests of New England in Connecticut and Long Island. You know, it was a privilege. It was a privilege, I know. Most of the world's peoples are stuck in the midst of inner cities or crowded suburbs or suburban slums. As I was later to find out in my visits to developing nations, the so-called third world, and later on, and my travels in the third world, later on, after I dropped out of Oxford University to go on the road. It's cash crops and natural resources that collect the people or push the people into crowded zones. The city system. The panic-induced overpopulation explosion is a ruse. The visitor rarely goes beyond the crowded city of a destination except to go to especially groomed resorts. The impression is easily conveyed that we are up to our ears in pollution. It is not so. Greed, maybe, but not population. Did I say pollution? Well, I'm not going to do this over again. This is the third time I've done this today. I'm just just let me reiterate that. We're up to our ears of pollution, that's for sure. You know, there's a... Every one of us has to go through barriers of negativity. Now, that's the best way I can interpret it for you. And one of the observable things of quote-unquote negativity is a kind of state of confusion, where I would say pollution, when I meant population, is like, you know? So you got to realize everybody is in the process of fighting against this sort of resistance. Not that we understand it. So reiteration is in order. Here it goes. The impression is easily conveyed that we are up to our ears in population. It is not so. We may be up to our ears in greed, yes, maybe, but not population. You so-called experts, where have you been? This traveler has logged over 200,000 miles, and I saw an empty planet. Even in Java, the most populated location on the Earth in the days I was there back in 1984, what I saw was a people being displaced by the plantation system. So you see, this suggests an ulterior motive. You know, it's amazing how people fall for this. Hey, I was no different. That's how I know. You know, if you know, what I was taught, the impression I was given, was very different from what I saw, and I covered a lot of territory. I wrote about this problem in my article about the painting High Water 96. Those who assert overpopulation, they're bought off. Somebody holds their leash. Never trust a textbook, kid. Never trust a textbook. They have to tone it down or they'd never sell. They'd never be able to sell their textbook. So they tone it down. Mediocre at best, but deliberately misinforming at the worst. And I'm afraid it's usually the worst. Misinformation. I wonder, so who wins the beauty pageant? Misinformation of 2011. Only a duck can fly information. Quack, quack, quack. Boom, boom. Hey, did you hear a quack and a boom? Yeah, Jack, what's that? Well, there must be a quack in the armory. Yuck, yuck, yuck. Want to buy a duck? Yuck, yuck, yuck. Anyway, so... Listen, never trust a textbook kit. They have to tone it down or they'll never sell the things, right? Mediocre at best, deliberately misinforming at the worst. I'm being polite here. The only way you're going to find out is to get the heck out of the comfortable institution and go out there and find out for yourself. Until then, shut up! You, who form such deadly opinions based only on the things you read, how dare you? How dare you? That seems pretty arrogant to me. Populate the emptiness and you'll see such prosperity that can handle 10 times the population you claim exists right now. I tell you, if you insist on having that attitude that people less fortunate than you are nothing but cattle, then you are going to have problems, and big ones, really soon as you experience the upheavals of world history. Here's another tip for you wannabe experts. Man doesn't have the ability to accurately assess populations. Nobody really knows for sure how many there are out there. What are they looking for? Justification to clear more potential plantations of villagers? Well then, this painting's for you. You need to step out of your pretty forest. I'm not the only one. We all need to step out of our pretty little forests. You need to step out of your pretty forest, too. Get out there and face up to the real problems. Get a handle on what's really going on. It will surprise you. But be careful. The people out there are going to resent you bitterly. You know, you who emerge from the privileged ranks, they're not going to welcome you with open arms. So the painting shows a self-portrait seen from the back as I leave the beauty of the forest and proceed to the city with sincere reluctance to assume the role of more than an artist. The unqualified observer looking behind the scenes. Oil on canvas, 1965, New York City. Probably early winter. This work is lost. Yeah, this is only from a photo. Fortunately, my mother saved the work, put it on her wall, and took a photo of it with a Polaroid land camera in those days. This is a retouch of Polaroid that I did with Photoshop, Adobe Photoshop. Oil on canvas, 1965, this work is lost.